त्रिरत्न शरणम नमो अमिताभाय नमो भगवते अरते सम्यक संबुद्धाय.
Today as well, like in the previous teachings, we will address the questions that I have been asked. Most of these questions have been asked by Buddhists themselves in order to clarify the teachings given by Hindu gurus on the Buddha and Buddhist philosophy and view. And I have been responding to these questions in order to address whether such teachings are correct or not. Thus, the Hindus who consider these gurus as your own guru do not feel hurt by this, as I am only clarifying whether what they are saying is accurate or not. And most of what they are saying has been incorrect.
Now, this one, Sri Sri Ravi Shankar Jiule, Bhannu Bhayeko Hoina, Vivekanand le bhaneko ho ra waha le tyalai copy garnu bhayo matrai ho. Yo pratha.
First of all, it was not Sri Sri Ravi Shankar Ji who originally said this, but it was Vivekananda. He simply copied it from Vivekananda. This practice of commenting on the Buddha in this manner can be found in many Hindu gurus. Actually, Vivekananda himself made his comments without even properly understanding what Shankaracharya had really said. And whatever Vivekananda stated as having been said by Shankaracharya was taken as being as such and repeated by Sri Sri Ravi Shankar Ji, Sadguru Ji, and many other Hindu gurus who are making such claims. If Shankaracharya had actually stated that he brought the Buddha and his teachings back into the Upanishadic form, then this would have implied that the Buddha had given Upanishadic teachings, and Shankaracharya simply brought them back to that. However, Shankaracharya has not made such a claim anywhere in his writings. In fact, in his text, the Brahma Sutra Bhashya, also known as Shariraka Bhashya, Shankaracharya clearly states,
Shankaracharya le ta Buddha lai spashtai nastik Brahma Sutra Bhashya, wahako Shariraka Bhashya ma spashtai bhaneko cha.
That the Buddha is a nastic or an atheist and a deluded person who, out of disgust towards the world, gave teachings that would delude people. He certainly did not say that the Buddha had just taught the teachings of the Upanishads in a slightly different way and that he, Shankaracharya, brought them back. Thus, Vivekananda himself was already wrong to say that Shankaracharya had made this claim. Another point is that there is a widespread belief that Shankaracharya was very intelligent and therefore he won debates against all the Buddhists in South Asia and thereby converted them all from Buddhism to Hinduism. But this is a folk tale. It is hearsay, a fabricated, wrong and false story, a mythical tale. How can we say this? Because first of all, Shankaracharya was from the 8th century.
यानि इन्डियामा नेपालमा आदि ठाउँ ठाउँमा हैन र विशेष गरेर अहिलेको इन्डियामा
but up until the 13th century there still existed great mahaviharas or great monastic learning centers in the Indian subcontinent meaning in India Nepal and other countries of South Asia and especially in India like Nalanda Vikramashil Vikramapur Sompuri Vallabhi, Jagadala, etc., where Buddhist philosophies were studied. The historical fact that these great Mahaviharas were still thriving even 500 years after Shankaracharya proves that Shankaracharya's winning debates with all the Buddhists due to his intelligence and converting them to Hindus is merely a fable. In those days, there was still a tradition in which the loser of the debate would become a disciple of the winner. But nowadays, even that tradition has vanished from the Hindu Dharma. It does not exist anymore. At that time, this practice prevailed among the Buddhists, the Hindus, and the Jains. Now this tradition has disappeared from all of South Asia. So this is the story, or folk tale, which is believed by most Hindus that Shankaracharya won debates against all the Buddhists and made them Hindus.
बुद्धको शिक्षाले औपनिषदिक बनाएको होइन, यसरी उहाँले जित्दै जित्दै बौद्ध बनाए भने दन्तकथा थिए, त्यही दन्तकथाको आधारमा विवेकानन्दले बुद्धको शिक्षालाई औपनिषदिक बनाए भनेर भनेको हो।
So first of all, Shankaracharya did not actually say that he brought back the teachings of the Buddha into the Upanishadic model. But there was this folk tale of him winning over the Buddhists and making them Hindus. It is based on this folk tale that Vivekananda claimed that Shankaracharya made Buddha's teachings Upanishadic. Talking about Shankaracharya himself, there are roughly 11 biographies on his life. Among these, the oldest one, Shankar Vijay by Anand Giri, is not available anymore. It had already disappeared 100 years ago during the British Raj in India. The second oldest is Shankar Digvijay, compiled by Madhav Vidyaranya. There are 2 cantos in this Shankar Digvijay, the 1st and the 15th, that contain interesting stories. The first canto relates to Kumaril Bhatta, and verses 93 to 95 relate how he, with the aid of King Sudhanva's army, killed all the Buddhists in Kerala and destroyed Buddhist stupas and converted the Viharas into Hindu temples, etc.
Kumaril Bhatta ra Shankaracharya samakalin ho. Kumaril Bhatta wahanda alikati jetho. उहाँहरू भेटेको पनि छ र उहाँको काम कुमारिल भट्टले शंकराचार्यलाई सौंपेको थियो।
And now Kumaril Bhatta and Shankaracharya were contemporaries. Kumaril Bhatta was a little older than Shankaracharya. The two of them met and Kumaril Bhatta handed over the responsibility of continuing his work to Shankaracharya as he was about to die. He actually committed suicide via self-immolation, by kindling fire in a pile of husk. He did this as a form of atonement because he had gone against his guru. He had learned logic and reasoning from a Buddhist guru and then he went against him. But such a thing is not practiced in Buddha Dharma. In fact, if one were to win over one's guru through logic and reasoning, the guru would instead become the disciple. However, Kumaril Bhatta's need for repentance was based on the norms of Hindu Dharma, and thus, believing he needed to die in that way, he killed himself. Shankaracharya met him right before this, and Kumaril Bhatta handed over the continuation of his work to him. Now in Canto 15, the first verse relates how Shankaracharya took the army belonging to the same King Sudhanva and went to various places, spanning from Rameshwaram, which is near Sri Lanka, all the way to the Himalayas.
अब यो प्रश्न उठ्छ कि मेधावी व्यक्ति ठाउँ ठाउँमा शास्त्रार्थ गर्नु सुधन्वको आर्मी सँगसँगै किन लगेको?
Now the question that arises is, why does such an intelligent person need to take an army along with him in order to debate, if that is what he was doing? Would you call such a person very intelligent if, in order to engage in a two-person debate, he backs himself up with an army who are, say, carrying Sten guns? Why does such an intelligent person need an army to support him? He should have won any debates against his opponents just by virtue of his intelligence. This narrative is in his own biography, in the oldest of the ones still extant, that is in the Shankar Digvijay. As I have already mentioned, the oldest one by Anand Giri has already disappeared and does not exist anymore. And there, in the same Shankar Digvijay, it talks about how he used this army to kill many Hindus or convert them to Advaita Vedantins, to basically eradicate them.
So, now, there are Buddhaharuko lai bhetako ta kahi pani paudaina. Tara hamile andaz garna sakcha ki Buddhale pani tyahi garnu khoje hola.
However, there is no mention of him meeting any Buddhists in his biography. But we can imagine that he must have taken similar actions towards the Buddhists who were in a class even beyond the other Hindus. And in his own text, the Brahma Sutra Bhashya, also known as Shariraka Bhashya, he calls the Buddha a liar, a thief, a fool mired in delusion, who gave antithetical teachings out of anger and aversion towards beings. With such a view of the Buddha, Would he have spared the Buddhists when killing his own Hindus? And how can we call a person who does this intelligent? If he was just debating, then there is no need for an army. The opponents sit together and debate, and whoever loses becomes a disciple of the other. Secondly, as I have noted earlier, if Shankaracharya had actually properly and cleanly won debates with all the Buddhists, then how could Mahaviharas like Nalanda, Vikramashil, Vikramapur, Jagadala, Vallabhi, Sompuri, Odantapuri still be standing and operating even 500 years after him? People from as far as Tibet, China, Indonesia, and other places continued coming to these Mahaviharas to learn Buddha Dharma until they were finally destroyed during the Muslim invasion. But this was not the fault of the Muslims. And I would like to make this point that the present-day Muslims should also not be blamed for this. However, it is a historical fact of that time. And even the Hindus of that period contributed to the destruction of the Buddha Dharma. Again, this blame should not be placed upon the present Hindu population. But it is a historical fact. Thus, regarding whether Shankaracharya was very intelligent, how can we consider a person who does this to be very intelligent? Then the question also states, the Buddha said that everything is nothing. Well, we recently dealt with the question about Shunyata. Only people who have no understanding of what Shunyata really means in Buddha Dharma make such a claim that the Buddha said that there is nothing. Neither Vivekananda nor Ravi Shankar understood what it means, because the Buddha has not said anywhere that there is nothing or that everything is nothing. If not, I challenge them and their disciples to show which Buddhist sutras or shastras state everything is nothing. Yes, they state it is shunya, but shunya does not mean nothing. It does not mean that there is nothing.
Kun sutra, kun shastra ma bhaneko cha. Na, waharle Buddhale bhanekai chaina.
Which sutra or shastra states this? Buddha has not said this, because that is not the meaning of shunya. And this has already been explained in the previous episode. If there are new viewers, please refer to the earlier episode where I have given a brief explanation of shunyata. Thus, this claim that the Buddha has said there is nothing is wrong. Then there is another point in this question, which is a very interesting one. It is an idea that has been prevalent since the time of Vivekananda and is used by the Vedantins even to this present day. That Shankaracharya said that there is nothing, the Buddha also said that there is nothing. But then they use this argument we have just been discussing, that Shankaracharya was so intelligent that he said that
Shankaracharya yeti medavi thie ki unle jasle khojyo ra payena ra pratyek kura kehi pani nabhayeko bujhyo tyahi nai atma ho.
Whoever searches and does not find and understands then that everything is nothing, that itself is the realization of Atma. Now this again brings us back to the topic of Sakshi, or witness, awareness, and Drashta, or seer, that we have discussed in an earlier teaching. The one that knows that there is nothing would be Sakshi, or witness. Let us delve into this a little bit deeper. The view that the Sakshi can know Shunya, or nothingness, is based on the philosophy of the Vedanta. The Buddha himself has never said anything about the Sakshi knowing Shunya, or not knowing it, or even that there is nothing such as Sakshi. So what is this Sakshi?
Kyo Sakshi? Tha paune wala, tesai gari ta gyata, dekhne wala.
It is the one who knows, thus it is gyata, or the one who sees, thus it is drashta. These are all the words of Vedanta. Thus the Sakshi is the knower of everything. This, in Bhagavan Buddha's teachings, in the sutras and shastras, is called vigyan, or consciousness, or mind. And it is said,
Vijanati iti vigyanam. Janne lai, janne bhayeko hunale, janne bhayeko hunale, vigyan.
Vijanatiti vijnanam, meaning because it knows, it is consciousness. or mind. So it is not that he did not say anything about knowing or sakshi. Only someone who does not know anything about the teachings of the Buddha Dharma will make statements such as, the Buddha did not have any idea of sakshi at all, but it is this sakshi which is Atma, the knower. And actually, in the Buddha's teachings, the sakshi itself is shunya. And shunya here again does not mean nothing, empty, void, and without a sakshi at all. But let us not get into shunyata here, as I have already explained it in an earlier episode. And anyone new here, please refer to that episode. The sakshi or witness is vigyan or consciousness or mind. And vigyan too is shunya. And the Buddha had certainly understood this very well in his time, as this definition of vigyan is still found in the Buddhist traditions. And the sakshi itself is anitya or impermanent, anatma or no self, and shunya or emptiness. And this sakshi, as referred to by the Vedanta and gurus like Ravi Shankar ji, Vivekananda ji, and as is stated to have been said by Shankara, that sakshi is Atma, as was said in the question as well. And what is Atma? I have already talked about this previously, but I am repeating it here. In his text Tattva Bodh, Shankaracharya writes, Atma Tarika, or what is Atma? He continues,
Sat Chit Ananda Swarupa, Sat Chit Ananda, Sat Chit भनेको थाहा पाउने हैन आनन्द भनेको आनन्द सबैले बुझ्छ
सत चित आनन्द स्वरूप सत चित आनन्द चित means to know and everyone knows the meaning of ananda which is bliss now not everyone can understand the meaning of sat as this is technical language that is often used in the hindu dharma the buddha dharma and in the jain dharma this sat is defined by shankaracharya himself later in the same text tattva bodh what is sat
kala traya api tishtati ti tinai kalama jo ek nas rahi rancha
It is kala traya api tishtati ti, meaning that which remains the same in all three times. This is sat. So what sat means is that which does not change, that which is changeless. Thus, what is atma? It is sat, or that which does not change, chit, or knowing, and ananda, or blissful. Buddha Dharma has no objection to chit and ananda. Chit is synonymous with vigyan, so that is that. But there is a problem with the definition of sat, and shunyata resolves this problem. Thus atma or sakshi or vigyan is actually shunya, possesses the quality of knowing, and is blissful. Now, Vedanta does not accept shunya in its definitions, and have not since the time of the Upanishads. So this was not started by Shankaracharya, but existed before him, in the Upanishads themselves. Shankaracharya only refined this approach. The problem is that if sakshi is sat, that is, it is unchanging and always remaining the same, then how is it able to know? So this is how intelligent Shankaracharya really was. How can such a sakshi know? Knowing is a process or a function. Process or function inherently implies change. There cannot be a process without change. There cannot be a function without change. If sakshi is able to know, then there has to be a function. There has to be a process. And when there is a process or function, then there is change. That which never changes cannot have a function and there cannot be a process, and thus it cannot know, as knowing is a process or a function. So that vigyan, which in the Vedanta is defined as sakshi, drashta, or gyata, cannot in any way be sat. But the Vedanta defines it as sat chit ananda. And Shankaracharya has also asserted that it is sat chit ananda. So here we see that it is the Buddha's teachings that reveal the flaws in the Upanishads and in Shankaracharya's views. The Buddha was that brilliant. And not the other way around, with Shankaracharya being able to point out the Buddha's mistakes and thus becoming known as being very intelligent for that. Because vigyan, which is the same as sakshi, has always been there in the Buddha Dharma. The Buddha himself had defined it.
अब यहाँ एउटा प्रश्न उठ्छ कि वेदान्तहरूले अलिकति आफ्नो ढाँचामा ढाल्दाखेरि चाहिँ थाहा पाउने मन अर्कै साक्षी अर्कै भन्ने किसिमले दुईटा बाँडिएको छ, यो पनि प्रसंग उठ्छ।
Now another issue arose when the Vedantins slanted this to fit their framework. They split the knowing mind and the sakshi or witness into two separate entities. The issue here is that now they have two knowers, the mind that knows as well as the sakshi that knows. But nobody in this world has experienced two knowers simultaneously. There is only one knower. In fact, even the word knower is incorrect in the Buddha Dharma. There is just one process of knowing. Because language is conditioned by avidya or ignorance or nescience, we use words that are generated from avidya. So there is only one process of knowing. If we are to rephrase it for an average person's understanding, there is only one knower, not two. How can both mind and sakshi or atma know at the same time? This is not possible. There is only one knower or a process of knowing. And because it is a process, it is changing. Even the word chit itself in the definition of sat chit ananda implies knowing. But how can there be knowing without a process? Then there is also another issue that arises here. So let's say for the moment that we forget about process and function. If the knower is permanent, eternal, and remains unchanging, then it would only know the one same object in a permanent, eternal, and unchanging way. Otherwise, it changes. The knower is dependent on the known object. Even if we were to accept a knowing of there being nothing, that state of there being nothing or of absence, which is called abhav in Sanskrit, even knowing this abhav implies a knowing. The abhav too is an object of knowing. As we said, the definition of a knower depends on knowing something. If nothing is being known, then it cannot be called a knower. So even abhav or absence is something that is known. For example,
जस्तै कि यो कोठा अहिले उज्यालो छ, यो कालो मुस्लो अन्धकार भए पनि त्यो कालो मुस्लो त थाहा पाइरा हुन्छ, भाषामा चाहिँ केही पनि देखेन, केही पनि थाहा पाएन भनिन्छ।
This room right now is bright, but even if it becomes pitch dark, we will still know that pitch darkness. But when expressing it in language, we say, I cannot see anything, or I'm not knowing anything. But we are seeing and knowing that pitch darkness. Similarly, that abhav or absence is also being known. The knower cannot be separate from the object of knowing. If there is nothing to be known, that is, if there is no object of knowing, not even pitch darkness or not even abhav, then there will be no knower either. Even from this, we can see that the object of knowing is constantly changing, and thus the knower also keeps changing. Now, if an unchanging, static, permanent sat, which is ultimately existing, knows, then whatever it knows in one single moment should be known in a permanent and eternal way for endless time. The issue here is evident. But it appears that the intelligent Vedantins have not thought about this as of yet. But the Buddha, who was truly brilliant, had already thought of it back then. Thus, it is erroneous to say that the Buddha gave Upanishadic teachings, or to say that the Buddha extracted his teachings from the Upanishads, but just taught it in a different way, and then Shankaracharya later brought it back to its Upanishadic form. As I already said, first of all, Shankaracharya himself did not believe it to be as such, because in his text, Brahma Sutra Bhashya, he clearly says in verses 231 and 232
manushya jati prani haru prati ghrina garne dwesh bhav le ris le galat shiksha diyera hineko bhanera baneko cha.
That the Buddha, who was himself deluded, gave wrong teachings out of anger and hatred and disgust towards humanity. Thus, to reiterate, the Buddha did not extract the Upanishadic teachings and teach them in a different way, nor did he just remodel the teachings of the Upanishads. And if we look at the teachings of the various Hindu gurus, if we read what Ravi Shankar ji has stated here, it is very obvious that he has taken it directly from what Vivekananda had said. If we refer to the complete works by Vivekananda, we will come across many contradictory statements that Vivekananda has made about the Buddha throughout the text. In some places, he says that the Buddha, in fact, taught the Upanishads. In another place, he claims that the Buddha was deluded and Shankaracharya later corrected him. And yet again, in another place, he says that there has been no one born in the Indian subcontinent who was as great as the Buddha. As I have been saying in my earlier teachings, all these gurus have never really studied and understood what Buddha himself actually taught, but only looked at the interpretations of Shankaracharya and Vivekananda. And they base what they are saying about the Buddha and Buddha Dharma only on this.
The yo prasna anusar na Shankaracharya Buddha ko shiksha lai Upanishad le dhalie. किनभने शङ्कराचार्यको 600 वर्षपछि पनि बुद्धको शिक्षा जगी जवाउ जल्दो चलिरहेको थियो.
Now going back to this question, Shankaracharya did not reform the Buddha Dharma back into the Upanishadic form because the Buddha Dharma was alive and continuing even 500 years after Shankaracharya. Granted that it had become a little weaker in all of South Asia. Why had it weakened? First, because Hindus like Shankaracharya and Mandan Mishra and various kings and Brahmins who were influenced by them had started to kill Buddhists. Secondly, the western areas of Asia like Pakistan, Afghanistan, Iran, Syria, and the areas north of that like Uzbekistan and Tajikistan, which were all Buddhist countries at one time, had all been converted into Islam by then. Although not everyone in Iran and Syria had become Muslim, and there were a lot of Buddhists there. In the archaeological ruins in Kizil, which is along the Silk Route, in the records of the mural paintings there, which are called Poba in Nepali and Thangka in Tibetan, it says that the mural was painted by the disciples of Priyaratna who came there. So Priyaratna was from Syria. And the name Priyaratna is different than any Arabic name we hear these days, such as Muhammad, Al-Pakri and the like, right? The Islamic invasion had already arrived in countries up to Afghanistan by the 12th or 13th century. But within India itself, the persecution of Buddhists was initiated earlier by Mandan Mishra and Shankaracharya. Before them, Hindus had not really resorted to using weapons and arms to kill and harm Buddhists. There were a few exceptions, like King Shashank of Bengal, who went to Bodh Gaya and cut down the Bodhi tree. Similarly, the last king of the Maurya dynasty, Brihadrath, was killed by Pushyamitra Shunga, who went on to establish the Shunga dynasty. And this Shunga dynasty were also involved in harming and subverting Buddhists, destroying Viharas, etc. But still, the Mahaviharas and Buddha Dharma continued to exist and function up to the 13th century. So Shankaracharya never defeated all Buddhists, nor was he more intelligent compared to the Buddha. On the contrary, the Vedantins still to this day have not been able to answer many questions posed by the Buddha. They just blindly believe whatever is written in the Vedas and the Upanishads to be the truth. So I have given these responses in accordance with the statements and claims made in the question here. We will stop here for today. Thank you.